a piano and piano keys are a bit analogous to single cells. And when those keys harmonize and play chords together, they can lead to a beautiful piece of music, which is analogous to an organism or a life. And in that organism, a single cell or a single key can lead to the destruction of the entire organism, as we see in diseases such as cancer. I've had several family members very close to me that battled cancer, and some have lost and some have won. I know how important it is to really develop new drugs, new diagnostics, new ways to make a big impact on reducing morbidity in this devastating disease.
Well, thank you very much for inviting us to Houston and to the lab. We're really looking forward to seeing it.
Yeah, we're very excited. Looking forward to it.
Totally fun.
I understand this was a background project. How did this all start?
The story really started for me as a graduate student at the Cold Spring Harbor Laboratory, and I was very interested on copy number variation in the human population. From there, I became interested in whether these copy number differences were also seen within tumors. And I spent a lot of my thesis cutting up tumors into smaller and smaller segments, but we never had information on individual cells. And so in the background, I had a project, a very high-risk project, trying to amplify DNA from single cells. And many people thought it was just not possible. But we were able to figure out amplification methods eventually that worked for single cells.
So what was the moment when you really started thinking that this thing is really gonna work?
Some of the first data sets that we got back, the copy number profiles we got from a single cell matched very well to a population of cells, millions of cells, in a cell culture system. And that was very exciting. And immediately we knew then, okay, we can get single cell information.
So there's very little material. How complete could you get those sequences?
90% or higher, so we can look at mutations in single cells across the entire genome at base pair resolution.
So what additional information do you get from single cells?
Although a tumor cell might look very similar from a pathologist or under a tissue section, the genetic differences can be quite dramatic. So let's take some time to explain the differences between a single normal cell and a single tumor cell. Our traditional model of cancer has been one in which a tumor is composed of a dominant clone which outcompetes all the other populations, and that is actually very homogeneous within the tumor mass. Our more modern view is one in which a single cell within a tumor can be genetically very different throughout the tumor mass. There can be multiple clonal populations present that might be interacting and cooperating during tumor growth, and we really need tools like single cell sequencing to be able to isolate out single cells from the tumor and study their genetic differences.
This must be challenging. What is the process you develop?
So we really developed three steps to do single cell sequencing. The first step is to isolate that cell. The second step is to amplify the DNA or the RNA. And the third step is to go on and do the sequencing reaction to sequence that DNA that you've amplified.
It sounds easy when you say it like that, right?
Let's go into the lab and I'll show you guys. So this is our cryomicrotome system, which allows to keep the tissue frozen while Anna goes through and cuts it with a very, very fine blade that will cut sections that are only one cell thick throughout the tissue. We're going to be looking at an early stage breast cancer called ductal carcinoma in situ. And we'll see ducts at the earliest stages of tumor development, where the tumor cells have started to proliferate within the ducts. Anna is going to use this 1 micron UV laser to cut around a cell, and then use another laser to burst that cell out of the tissue and into a collection vessel. So now we're going to go through the whole genome amplification process to amplify the DNA from 6 picograms up to nanogram amounts so that we can generate sequencing libraries and do our quality control steps. So all of that work has to be done here under a clean hood, which is sterile, and it's very critical before the DNA has been amplified not to contaminate it with any bacteria or even viral DNA. Okay, so this is the third step of single cell sequencing. It's the next generation sequencing part. So this is one of the runs that's going on right now on the Illumina machine. If we sequence the whole genome of a single cell, we'll be getting back about a terabyte of data from each cell.
That's a lot of data from a single cell. How do you make sense of all that data analysis, and what's the significance of all that?
We use this data to detect mutations that are both biologically important, but also mutations that are clinically important and might be actionable by targeted therapies or even chemotherapies or other therapeutic strategies in the clinic. So here's an example where we sequence four different single cells. And in these four cells, we've identified a mutation in PIK3CA. And we found that that mutation, when we sequenced it across many, many single cells, every single tumor cell had that mutation. And there's actually good PIK3CA inhibitors, so they would have benefited this patient quite a bit. What's really important for informing precision medicine or personalized medicine and guiding targeted therapy, try and get these tools into the clinic where they can make a big impact on reducing morbidity. And that's why getting that single cell genomic information is so important for understanding cancer.
It was amazing to see that laser just cut out that single cell.
I know, it just like blew it away. But see how far we've progressed in this field of cancer research, from studying masses of tumors down to the very single cells that make them.
Just imagine what it will do for cancer diagnosis and treatment.